Good afternoon and welcome to the first webinar from Academic Transfer in 2019. We hope you will all like it, and if you do, there will be more. That's what I can give away already. We currently have 34 attendees of the 100 plus people that signed up. So I want to wait one more minute before kicking it off. But if you have not done so, please grab a drink, make sure you're comfortable. And then within the next 45 minutes, we will tell you all about doing a PhD in the Netherlands. Okay, welcome. I think everybody is able to listen to us and hear us. And like I said, welcome. Whether this is your first ever webinar or maybe you've done it before, let me briefly introduce the way that we can interact with each other. Of course, you have two hosts here besides me, Alex and Han. We have also Els. And to give you an idea of how we look in real life, I want to now share us. You can now see us on camera if everything is all right. And so we'll be signing off because we do not want to be distracted by the cameras. And we'll be returning to the PowerPoint that we presented to you. So if you have a question or a remark, there's two ways to interact. You can either raise your hand, and I've seen that somebody already did that. And you can also ask us a question in the question bar. So if you do that, we will be able to relay the question to the group and answer them in general. Or if it's a personal question for you personally, then we'll also be able to get back to that afterwards. If you think that you want to show something, then please feel free to do so. Yeah, so this is the screen that we want to show you. As I said, questions, remarks, and other responses, that's the way to go. That's where we can find them. And first, to get an idea about who we're talking with, we are currently in Utrecht in the Netherlands, where it's starting to rain. But we are, of course, curious where you are all over the world. And with the help of polls, we can find that out. So please answer this question by clicking on what continent you're from. And we had to make, there were only five choices max. So that's why we decided to go for this setup. And we see the votes coming in. So we have 76% of the votes already in. And we are actually kind of surprised, I think, with the results ourselves.
Yes, everyone from all over the world, from Africa, Americas, Asia, Europe.
Yeah, only nobody from Australia.
No.
So, and we were thinking about adding Antarctica as well, but I think that would have yielded no result as well. So I'm closing the poll for the people who did not yet vote. I'll give you five more seconds. And then what we will also do is we'll share the results. So everybody is literally on the same page. Okay, good. So in order for me to share the results with you, here we go. 85% of people are from Europe. Er zijn ook wat Nederlandse mensen. Hartelijk welkom. That was a little Dutch you heard there, but we'll keep this all in English for the remainder of this course. And I say we go on with the meat of the story, because that's of course the most important thing. For those of you that do not know Academic Transfer, we are a non-profit organization which is based in the Netherlands. And as a cooperative, we work for and with all the 14 research universities. Besides that, there are five university medical centers and two research organizations, and they all have a whole slew of institutes. So you see all the logos here, and you've maybe also seen the logos earlier when we showed in the webcam in the back. Academic Transfer exists now for 20 years. And it's our role to tell people about how exciting working in science is in the Netherlands. And for the people that are already in science and research and that are looking for a job, that they can find them all in one convenient place. So you don't have to go to all the websites from all the universities. You can simply find that on Academic Transfer. So far the commercial message. Now the story that we're going to share with you in the next 45 minutes, along the lines of what you see on your screen, we will of course go into the background. You may or may not know where PhDs are coming from and what it really means. In the next slide, I already give it away. There might be some short explanations. And we will then talk about the difference of PhDs throughout the world, basically, and those that we have in the Netherlands, what sets them apart. When you have done that and also answered your questions, we're going to, of course, talk about PhD opportunities. They cannot only be found on Academic Transfer, but you can also find them in other places. And it's all nice and all, a 3, 4, 5, 6 year stint to get your PhD degree, but what can you do with it afterwards? We also hope to shed some light on that with you as well. And then, of course, there are questions that we do not know yet that you can answer us. Currently, we do not have questions, so we'll go on. And this is maybe interesting. If you have seen, if you have not seen this picture before, can you please raise your hand? So if you see in your menu, I see the hands raised. So a lot of people have never seen this picture before. If you want, we can send you it afterwards. But yeah, the official abbreviation is, of course, Philosoph Doctorate. And to what I've learned, the first one was awarded in Paris already in the 15th century. And it isn't until the 20th century that it started to go across the globe as the highest or the third level education. And of course, when you obtained a master, it's a nice way to continue in science and in research if you are interested. So yeah, what a PhD actually is, we can look at it at this way. But fortunately, the Dutch universities have a system in which they describe basically every job that is available in the university. And from that description, from the UFO system, is as it's called, we have found this definition. So as a PhD, you will be trained to act as an individual scientist. So you can on your own, but of course with help from others, do research and find information. And you do that under the supervision of a professor. This professor has the right to grant you the PhD when you're done. There is also a great presentation that I have not included in the presentation, but that you can maybe Google. It's by an American professor, Matt Mead. What is a PhD? And that's also actually nice. He has a nice animation of it, and we'll include it in later versions. But for now, what you see here on the screen is the official definition of a PhD according to what the Dutch universities have. So you could basically say that's the PhD in the Netherlands already, and I don't think it's really distinct or different from PhDs in other countries, but there are some interesting differences that we're going to talk about right now. And this might scare you as a big scheme, as a big structure, but what you actually have here is the whole Dutch education system in one picture. The biggest, darkest, bluest bar at the bottom is the primary education of het basisonderwijs, and through all kinds of secondary education, you end up at a university or a university of applied sciences, and that is where you can obtain a master degree. And if you have obtained that master's degree, you can go on. And talking about obtaining master's degrees, what we are curious about, do you want to tell us what we want to know from the audience?
Yeah, we would like to know when you did obtain your master's degree, or when you will obtain your master's degree.
And fortunately, we have, again, a poll for you. So if you please let us know when you did or did not a PhD. And we have two questions already that we address in a minute after we have looked at the results of the polls. Okay, we are currently at 80% of the audience that has voted, and we are currently with 51 people. So roughly there are 4 or 5 more people that need a couple of seconds to enter. And this is very, again, for me, interesting results, because mm-hmm. what we were thinking or aiming or hoping for, that we had third or fourth year PhD master people here, and we have actually a lot of people who have their PhD already for a while. We're going to show that in
master
a minute.
Master degree for a while.
Yeah. Master degree for a while. Thank you for filling me in there. I will close the poll right now, and of course I will share the results with you. So what we have here is more than half of the people already have a master's degree, and the biggest chunk, you've already got it in 2017, and that's actually, I think, good news.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also a challenge with that. So the good news is that you can go straight into your could go straight into a PhD because you have obtained the master's. The challenge is that PhDs are usually started in a regular convention within 2 years after obtaining your master's degree. So if you obtained your master's degree in the summer of 2017, that means you're still right on track and you still have a couple of months to land it. And it doesn't mean that you cannot get a PhD position by the end of this year. However, there are more new, fresh people with master's degrees. So you maybe have to do a little bit more explanation of why you are entering to a PhD 2 years after you graduated from your master's degree. Like, as I said, we have some questions. The first question was from Usma, and he or she asked, are there opportunities in science only, or are there also in other types of sciences? The short answer is there are definitely PhDs in other sciences, and we will cover that in future slides. We have mm-hmm. that in the course of this presentation. There is also a question about Jeff Peters. He says, so there are no PhDs for bachelors, and the definition or the rule is that you should have a master's degree. However, never say never. If you have a good story, you may be able to convince the professor or the PI, but it's very unlikely that with a PhD, with only with a bachelor's degree, you can segue into PhD trajectories. You really have to have this degree. Now, the skills needed to complete a PhD, asked by Tagrit Dinar, we'll cover that. And we also have a question about, does it matter how long you did the master's? Is 10 years too long ago to qualify? It kind of depends on what you have been doing, and it also depends on the type of PhD that you can or will do, and that's what we'll explain also in a bit, because we have in five slides, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about the different PhDs that we have in the Netherlands. Okay, so we know now who we're talking to. And congratulations, some of you already have the master's degree, and you know that it's the postgraduate third cycle, the PhD is what you're working towards. Now, the good thing is in the Netherlands is that you have also something what we call a professional doctorate. That is what they call the professional doctorate in engineering. That's a PDN, it's a 2 year course, and you will also be funded within the technical universities, but we're not gonna cover that. What I wanted to tell you is the really thing that sets PhDs in the Netherlands apart from other countries, and that's this pyramid, this career trajectory, so to say. In most countries, if you do a PhD, you're still considered to be a student, and you're have to pay tuition fees, or you have to bring money to the table in order to do your PhD. But in the Netherlands, the regular scheme as a PhD is that you are employed by the university. A PhD is really regarded as a job, more as than as a training position or actually a student position. That is for the majority of the PhDs that is the case. So that is really sets it apart. There are actually only a couple countries in the world, between 3 and 5, that have this scheme. So we'll get better to that. Thank you all for your questions. We still see questions coming in, so at a brief moment we'll check whether they are. I have some questions about applying for the EU. We'll cover that. I have questions about sharing the slides. which we certainly do. And we actually have somebody says, I have already got accepted for a PhD and starting a few weeks after 2-year governmental job. Will part of this webinar be of interest for me? That's a good question. Congratulations on your PhD. If it's in the Netherlands, you might learn a couple of new tips and tricks. So it's interesting because it covers research funding and top sectors and research in the Netherlands, but it's really at your own discretion. The 5-year gap for professional experience could be useful. That's what we also heard. So since it's a job, it's considered a starter job. If you want to do a PhD with more experience, it's a little bit an extra explanation or an extra, could be an extra challenge. But that's, of course, if we're talking about the regular employee PhD, like I said, most of the people in the Netherlands are paid by the university. However, if you are able to obtain funds from somewhere else, maybe in your own country, from a government or a local program that gives money, you can then look for a Dutch professor and ask her or him if they are willing to counsel you and if they're willing to work with you. And if you then bring your own money, you can do a PhD and you'll be considered a bursary PhD. So this is especially for the people that have more experience. Yeah, if you can acquire more funds, then of course the threshold of entering you might be a little bit different if you bring your own money than if you are funded. Now, we also have a question that says about somebody that says, if I'm, is there an age limit to doing PhDs? Well, I have heard that nowadays there's actually people well into their 70s that still get PhDs. And they are usually the third type of PhD. That's what we call the external PhDs. External PhDs means is that you just have a regular job. You don't have to pay tuition fee. You won't be paid either, but you're just doing your PhD for, let's say, the intellectual challenge. And your professor will then, in his spare time or somewhere in the course, will help you with that. So if you want to get a PhD, but yeah, I hate to say it, you are you've left of you obtained your master's degree already more than a decade ago, then and you cannot obtain funds through a bursary and maybe can obtain a fund, but you not they cannot guide you 5 days a week or on a regular trajectory, then there's always still the external PhD scheme available. But we do not see that a whole lot. No matter what type of PhD you do, there is a similarity into what you have to in what you have to do. So these are actually the core activities of doing a PhD, and it depends from field a little bit, and it also depends on the way the research funding is already there. If your PI or your principal investigator has got the money, and he or she maybe has already a bigger research proposal, and they may actually have a work package available. So the research proposal and the research planning part may be a little bit smaller, and you really dive into the research straightforward. Now, the publication of your research, of course, also depends on the field. In medical sciences and science, technology, engineering, and math, there's a different approach towards arts and humanities or social sciences. So that kind of depends. But all in all, no matter what way you publish, all these publications have to come together into a book or a booklet, which is called the doctoral thesis. And yeah, you should be able to get that down in 3 to 5 years. And if that all goes well, you'll be going to a nice committee and you'll be getting your PhD degree. Now, there is something that you may wonder or may have missed in this slide, and that's the teaching and supervising of students. That's not always necessary. That's also something that can be that can be dependent on the position. So sometimes when you see positions advertised, it states teaching and supervising students, and other moments it doesn't have that one. So that's what it says about what you should do along these 3 to 4 years. And if you're lucky, then the research proposal and the writing part up front is a little bit smaller. But sometimes there's also open calls. This happens more in social sciences, that they say, well, look, we've got money to fund PhDs, but we're interested in what you have to share or what you want to bring. So let me see here before I go on with my next slide about a little bit more about questions. If we have something here that you say, well, this we really want to talk about. Is there a difference in getting a PhD position with 1 year or 2 years after the master's degree? No, that's not a big problem. For international students, if you acquire a bursary PhD, what type of visa will be given by the IND? That's a good question by Jeffrey Patterson. The IND, you must know, is the Dutch Immigration Services. They have thresholds and standards. You should be able to have a sustainable living, and I think that that's roughly around 1,300 euros net. So it depends on if your funding organization provides you with enough money, then IND will clear you. But the good thing is that all universities have international offices, and they have people there who are really specialized in all these questions. So if you explain your situation to them, and it depends on the country where you're from, it depends on the money that you can bring, and then they will have the best answer for you. The good thing is, of course, if you are hired by as a regular employee, then you have other criteria that will apply. And of course, then the salary is already high enough. And if there's special clearances or requirements, that is usually not used to exclude people. The only thing that we know, because you cannot ask in a vacancy that we only want people from a certain geography. What happens if there's a PhD position that is funded to Europe, they might have eligibility criteria. And that usually means that you shouldn't have been in that country where you do the PhD for 2 years. So if you're doing a PhD in the Netherlands, a master's in the Netherlands, and you see a European funded PhD in the Netherlands, there's a chance that you are not eligible. But if you've been doing a PhD somewhere in Europe and you see the PhD in the Netherlands, you might come to the Netherlands. So Jeffrey answered his saw his question answered. So you're welcome, Jeffrey. We take that away. Let us wrap up this little part about PhD student candidate fellow. As we already said, we have the PhD, you have the bursary PhD, and you can find personal funding. One way to obtain funding for the Netherlands specifically is if you go to a website which is called Grant Finder. You may find PhD scholarships there that are really instigated and originated around certain geographies. There is an Orange Tulip Fund. I don't know if it funds PhDs, but it definitely will finance some more education, and maybe you as a visiting scholar as well. And if you go to grantfinder.nl, you can see what's available there. Maybe if you're already a junior scientist, and even if you are a professional, there are schemes that you can come over for a shorter stay. I have a question with the master degrees. Yeah, I will explain that a little bit. Maybe this is the right way to explain that. You have master's degree from research universities and master's degrees from universities of applied sciences. It might be that people think that there's a difference, and it might be that the professor can see them as a difference. But in that case, if you are well lined up or qualified, but you maybe need some more, a little bit more academic skills, there's an additional program to work with that. In my case, I would always recommend Christabel then to go to the people who are mentioned in the vacancy and ask, look, this is my background, I have my master's degree, what do you think is the chance? And if they say, well, it sounds interesting, it's good, apply. Or maybe they say, well, if you can work on this, or while you're working with us, you improve some other things, then it might work out as well. Good. Let me tell you a little bit more about this funding in the Netherlands, because funding is, of course, very important in order to do research. In short, this is the scheme that we have. On the top, we see the Dutch government. They give their money either to the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science, or they give it to the Ministry of Economic Affairs. If it goes to the Ministry of Education, they give their money straight to universities, and all the professors and researchers are paid through what you see, the first blue arrow. In Dutch, it's called Eerste Geldstroom. So it's the first tier of funding. Is money that goes straight from the Ministry of Education to universities to pay for research. Unfortunately, it's not happening that often, or it's not a lot of the money that they have for free research available. Usually this money is meant to pay salaries for researchers, teachers, pay for housing and stuff like that. So the most money in the Netherlands to do research is allocated through NWO, and they have all kinds of schemes and programs. And as a researcher, you go into a competition, you answer a call for proposals, and then you hand it over to NWO, and they have a committee, and they have all scientists from throughout the Netherlands, and they will look at the science schemes that are the most interesting or the most important. And based on that, they will award money. And if then somebody gets funding, that can also be used to hire a PhD or to hire a postdoc or to set up a research group. So that's why second tier funding is very important, because that generates a lot of research positions. Now, we also have money that is coming through the Economics Affairs Department, sometimes with industry or sometimes in conjunction with funding from Europe. And that's what we then call third cycle funding, third tier funding. So sometimes you may see a vacancy in which it says this position will be in that company, and then the company will pay a part of, they will pay money toward the university, and the university will then pay your salary. But you will work in the company, you will get paid by the university, and you will obtain your PhD from the university. That happens. That's very much doable in the Netherlands. Now, one final slide about the Ministry of Economic Affairs. It has to do with the top sector approach. This is basically where our government said we want to be, Netherlands wants to excel in these nine areas. And as you can see already, it's not only high tech, it's not only engineering and math, it's also other things like agriculture and horticulture, and also energy, but also the creative industry. So really, we have lots of things going on in the Netherlands. Now, after this whole scheme, why would you want to do a PhD in the Netherlands? And we can maybe answer that question, but we are more curious, of course, by your input. And therefore, we want to ask you the next question. Why do you want to do a PhD in the Netherlands? Oh, and before I forget, prior in a previous poll, you could only answer one question, but now you can click as much dots if you like. So feel free to answer more, to include more answers in your reply than earlier. Okay, we have 84% of the people who voted. We'll wait another 10 seconds for us to sort out also the questions, because we had a big number of them. So thank you very much. Okay, great. We'll close the poll right now because we, of course, have more slides to cover and we don't want to keep you too busy. A very nice mixed bag of results. And here we go. There are still people that think we have great weather in the Netherlands. Well, it depends on a day-to-day basis. The quality of higher education in the Netherlands is very good. Yes, thank you very much. It's nice to see that roughly one-fifth of you have been recommended about the Netherlands, and of course the rich and international scientific legacy of the Netherlands. That's nice. Funny thing is that as far as friendly people go, we get the lowest answer. So we might have to talk a little bit about that in a second. Good. So why would you want to do a PhD in the Netherlands? The Netherlands is one of the, you see it here on the slides, and English is really our second language. And it even goes so far, if there are expatriates who come here and want to learn a language, they sometimes complain that once people find out that Dutch is not their native tongue, that people start speaking English with them to make it easier. So people want to be friendly and accommodating by speaking English. But that sometimes doesn't work out because people want to learn Dutch as well. The good news is, since everybody speaks English, lots of our research and education is also done in English. So as far as the requirement of being fluent in Dutch, that is not so much the case. It can be dependent on your subject. And if you want to work in a university medical center and you have to deal with patients, then of course it would be great if you speak Dutch or at least have a working knowledge so you can talk with people around the bed. But for other fields, that not that interesting or relevant to go to. Yeah, of course, gateway to Europe. We are in the northwestern country of the Netherlands. And for you who do not have an idea how big we are, you can drive from the southernmost point to the northernmost point in only 3 hours. Now, and if you would drive 3 hours from Amsterdam, you would already be well beyond Brussels. And if you take a train for 3 hours, you'll be in London. And if you take a plane for 3 hours, you would be well beyond Berlin. So you can basically visit whole Europe if you're based from the Netherlands, and that's really pretty close. Now, earlier we had this question about science in the Netherlands, and this is the second Dutch word that you'll hear in this presentation. The funny thing is that the English word science in Dutch is translated into wetenschap. Now, the nice thing about wetenschap is that it covers all fields. In the Netherlands, we do not really have a distinct word or a separation because wetenschap encompasses both arts and humanities, science, technology, engineering, and math, as well as the social sciences. Of course, we do have Dutch words for kunst and humanoria and sociale wetenschappen, but that basically says it. Social sciences is sociale wetenschappen. We just cherish the fact that science of wetenschap is a broad term. It defines everything. And it's practiced in a whole range of institutions that we already covered. Sarah asks, does it also cover law? Yes, the social sciences is where some people put in law, but they're all together also a separate category. We have another distinction in the Netherlands that I do not want to confuse you with, but even in that three-tier distinction, law goes with social sciences, as is business and economics, by the way. It's all part and considered as social sciences, as well as psychology. Good. Now, the other thing is the open minds. In the Netherlands, people really like to speak their mind. So some people say we're blunt or direct, but people really want to exchange ideas. And your future professor will really appreciate it if he or she gives you an assignment and you ask questions and maybe even come back with a view that is not directly in line with what they want you to do. So that open discussion is really a trait. If you compare this to maybe other countries around the Netherlands, there is more strict hierarchy. And if the Herr Professor asks you to do something, it will be very difficult to say, Nein, vielleicht nicht, then you maybe will run into more problems. And in the Netherlands, that it's okay to talk about science. And that has brought us some great things in the past, because what a lot of people do not know is that we have already a whole slew of Nobel Prizes. Of course, the last one was Ben Feringa in physics. It was only a couple of years ago. And we're always kind of proud of this. So we make this a trivia question. And if you guys do a bar quiz, because they're popular in the Netherlands, but I can imagine throughout the world, if somebody asks you how many prizes the Nobel one, if you're sticking to the around the 2021, then yeah, then you must be good. Then it will be great. But okay, let's not look back a whole lot and not only look in countries just around us. Let's look at this on a global and actual scale. And here you see, based on the rankings, where the Dutch universities end up. And actually, we're kind of the best kept secret. You see here, we're doing pretty well, actually. In all the different ratings that we have, we see a big number of universities. And if you take in mind that there's only 14 research in the universities in the Netherlands, and we are able to get either 12 or 13 in the top 200 of the biggest rankings, then that's an achievement that we are very proud of, so to say. So, I have some questions coming in. David will ask if the video will be uploaded to YouTube. Well, I have to clear it with my boss, because I don't know if the sound is good enough and if the story I tell will will add up. But we probably share them with you who joined the webinar. So you will have access to the material later on. Good. Does everybody still want to do a PhD? We do not have a question, a poll question about that one here yet, but we do want to tell you a little bit more about finding those PhD opportunities. Here's a number of job boards or places that you may or may not know where you can find PhD positions. Of course, academic transfer for PhD positions that are in the Netherlands. But if you want to have a broader view, you can also check out euraccess.eu, because on Euraccess, if there are PhD positions that are funded to Europe, the research groups have to post them on that website. Now, sometimes they can be disguised as early stage researchers or ESR, but mind you, they are really PhD paid for positions. If you're thinking about other countries, you might also consider the other websites that were mentioned here. We do not see them as competitors, but they kind of are. But they all have their own area where they are good in, where jobs at ACH UK is primarily aimed at, you guess it, UK. And Academics Day is more aimed at Germany. And there are, of course, also bigger boards that you can use. But let's stick with academic transfer. This is how our website currently looks. And to stay up to date doesn't mean you have to go to our website every day. We like that, but we understand that you guys have other stuff to do and you have a busy life. So feel free to think of a search query, and then from that search query, create an email alert. Just if you click on the email alert, you'll be asked to leave your email address. We will not spam you, we will not have a resume, but it will only be used to send you the positions that are applicable to whatever query you made. So that's what we put in there. And we also have another nifty feature that has been introduced at the end of last year. And we were kind of curious if you have already discovered that and if you have already used that. So just a quick palate cleanser question is, have you matched your CV yet? It's very interesting. We see the live results coming in and we see things changing, and we are very happy with the results so far. I will close the poll in 5 seconds. We are currently at 84% response rate. I think that'll do. And of course, I share the results with you. There's already a number that have tried them, and some people have not done so well. You're kindly invited. this is what it looks like. If you click on that button on the website, you just throw in your resume and it will help you with showing positions that are available. In all honesty, it's still a beta and we're still working to tweak some things out. So it might be if you throw in a resume about with a master's that it will give you already postdoc positions, or it will already give you other positions, but at least you get an idea of the groups and what Dutch universities have to offer. So you can then use that one. But besides our website, there are of course other ways and opportunities to find PhDs. Let's not forget that more and more professors and maybe friends and colleagues that you studied with are hanging out on social networks. So you can maybe listen closely and see if somebody gets funding or if there's a news article that they're starting a research line, and all these things can be used to find PhD opportunities. There are also career events. For instance, in Indonesia, there's in November an event, and also in China, we've just been to an event in the US. So keep your eyes posted for these kinds of events. And that might also be an opportunity to meet people from universities or Dutch universities and explore with them the opportunities that are available. And now I think it's time for me to drink some water. And with all kinds of pleasure, I give the floor and the mic to Els, who will tell you more about how to get a PhD position in general.
Thank you, Alex. I see we still have 4 minutes left. I hope you will stay tuned for my for my talk, my part of the webinar, because probably most of you still have one question pending, and that is, how do I get a PhD position? Unfortunately, there are more people interested in doing a PhD than there are positions, so only the best will get through. But there are definitely some things you can do yourself to make the searching process a little bit smoother. So I would like to start with some requirements that almost every Dutch university asks for. And the first thing is a master's degree. Alex already explained it. In the Netherlands, you need to finish your master's degree before you can do a PhD. Secondly, what can be very helpful is, and what every university wants you to send in with your application, is a list of your master courses and your grades. So this is something you can already prepare. Another tip is to include the titles of your dissertations and publications in your resume, because then the professor gets an idea of your research interest and also your experiences. If you got an article published, it goes without saying that you give attention to that as well. We already talked a little bit about this, but in the Netherlands, it's very... if you want to do a PhD, it's necessary to have a really good level of English, and most of the universities ask for a proof, so you need to present your TOEFL or IELTS certificate, and every university has their own requirement, but most of the time I think it's you need to have a 6.5 score for the IELTS test and like 90 points for the online-based TOEFL test. Be aware that these certificates are only valid for 2 years, so don't get your degree too early, because that would be a pity. Another tip is look for references, because every university asks for 2 or 3 academic references, and think carefully about who your referees will be. Who would you choose? You can think of your master supervisor or any other academic staff, like a teacher who marked your work, or it can also be an employer if the research area is similar to your employment. And always speak to your referees before you submit an application, because this gives you the chance to explain to them why you want to do a PhD and what goals you have yourself. Let's see. Summarize examples of independent work and teamwork. In almost every position, you find this requirement because during a PhD, you need to work by yourself a lot of time. So professor looks for students who can easily work by themselves. And if you already think of examples in your past, then it's very helpful to have that already prepared. Of course, you also need to work in a team. You are working in a research group. So think of examples of great collaboration in your past and prepare yourself well. What can be helpful too is to write a research statement or a small research plan. Because there are different kind of PhDs in the Netherlands, and sometimes the research project is already fixed by or already defined by the professor, and it's like applying to a job. But sometimes there is only a research subject, and you are asked to send in your research ID with your application. So if you if you are passionate about your field, if you already have an ID, write it down. This can be really helpful during the application procedure, but also during the interview you might have. If you bring your own funding, then you probably need to write your own research proposal as well. And on our website, if you fill in your scientific field, and if you find a position that match your research ID, you can always check the below the paragraph additional information. We always mention the professor, and so you can contact the professor, because proactivity is really appreciated in the Netherlands. So really feel free to contact the professor. And the positions on our websites can be helpful. So just look, as I said before, look for a PhD on our website and see if you find some contact details that might be useful for you.
Yeah, and this is also something that I mentioned earlier, so you can take a sip of water now. And also, some of the questions you ask in the question panes are so personally and so directly related to the positions that you see, that in that case, the best way to go forward is always to reach out to the organizations. And if your papers are good and if you have done in English, people still want some kind of proof. And this could also be a great way if you manage to get somebody on the phone, or if you write a nice email, that they will get an idea about what your English language really is. So that's in that cases, if you think, well, I'm not sure, or I my score is not that high, but I'm still my comment should be doable, then just go for it and just reach out.
Yeah, thanks. It goes without saying that you need to do your homework. So do research into the research group, the faculty, the university, and their recent work. And follow the stated application procedure. Make sure that you send in every document they ask for. That is the least you can do. In our digital world right now, it's also very important to be visible online and to brand yourself a little bit. I'm not sure if you all have a LinkedIn profile, but in the Netherlands, almost every academic has a LinkedIn profile. If you have one, please make sure it's up to date. Because it tells it gives an impression of who you are and what your ambitions are, and it's pretty sure that your new employer will have a look at it as well. The following point is a network. It's always good to meet, for example, your master supervisor, or talk to someone who has already a PhD or is doing a PhD. Talk to a teacher at the specific faculty. If you're proactive, people will notice, and yeah, they can redirect you to the right people. I hope these tips already are helpful for you to find a position that suits you.
Yeah, and before we go into the final segment, because that's nice thing about we paid our telephone minutes, so we can go on for another 5 minutes. Actually, we thought it's 45 minutes webinar with 15 minutes Q&A. So if we're answering the questions, it's okay to finish around six. I'm going to take some questions. Somebody says that if my master's degree was in English, do I still need an IELTS or TOEIF English score? Everything that is mandatory is determined by the people who want to hire you, or the organization that wants to hire you. Sometimes or often they will ask for a score, but if you can include a research paper or your master's thesis, and they see that your English is up to speed, they're probably not that stuck with going for that figure. Then it's just nice to go. And this is another great question that came in by Christabel about when do PhD starts, in spring semester or in fall semester. Nice thing about the Netherlands is that you basically have what we call rolling recruitment. Throughout the year, there will be positions available. Funding comes in throughout the year. Positions will be created throughout the year. So that will be no problem. Also, I had earlier, somebody says, I'm not from the EU. Do I apply from my home country or from the Netherlands? If you see a position, apply. It doesn't matter where you are. The only thing you should take into account is, are you kind of available, and do you have your master's degree when the PhD should start? But that's even if you're a nice student and they want you and they have to wait for two or three more months, that should not be a problem. These things can happen. People are kind of flexible. One question also about the English test asked by Elvira Rienstra, is that mandatory for Dutch persons? I could almost answer this question in Dutch, but I want to give the answer to other people as well. If it's mandatory or if it's required, it's up to the organization that you work with. It kind of depends on the field as well. If you're doing something like Nederlands literatuur, then you probably do not have to do a lot of publications in English, and the aim might not be that high. Whereas if you do something in an international setting, then of course they want some kind of proof that your English is up to par, and maybe your job interviews in English. So I would say you don't have to do the test if you can make prove somehow that your English is up to scale if it's required.
Yes, I believe then when you have finished your secondary education in the Netherlands, then you already have that degree of English. So I think you are exempt then.
Yeah. One other question that we had is, can you get a PhD without publications, asked by Nina Engels?
Of course.
Yeah, if you have a publication, quote, you can't see me making quote marks here, but of course publications like in a journal or in open source are open access journals, are done during your trajectory. So if you enter your PhD, maybe you have a working paper, maybe you have like your master thesis, they can count as publications. But I don't think people expect you to have scientific publications. That gives, if you have them, it may give you an example or an advantage. Mm-hmm. That's what I wanted to say. But if you do not have them, then people will understand that you do not have that yet. Okay, good. What can you do beyond the PhD?
Yes, what's next? So let's go one step further. What's the added value of doing a PhD? Because when you have your doctorate degree, you are not only experienced in doing research, but there are a lot of other skills that you have trained during these 4 years as well. And we would like you to be aware of these skills as well, because as you might know, there are only a handful of professors. And so it can be possible that you are going to work outside academia. And then it's good to be aware of the skills that you've trained during your PhD, and which are an added value for your future career outside academia as well. So you see the list on your screen. You practice some analytical skills, critical thinking, doing research is like managing a project. Sometimes you even have to define the budget. You have some leadership management experience. You're working with people from all over the world, so you build up some intercultural sensitivity as well. And as we told earlier, teaching can be part of your PhD. So you have experience in giving a lecture or work with students, evaluate their work. So these are all skills that are really valuable for you after your PhD. And they aren't only an added value in the Netherlands, they are also an added value all over the world. You can work everywhere, so you're like a global citizen after your PhD. And we would like to finish with this picture. We know that it takes a lot of motivation and preparation to find a PhD position. And sometimes it feels safe to stay in your comfort zone. But our tip is to step outside that zone and challenge yourself, because that is where the magic happens.
Yeah, that is. And of course, we are curious if after almost 55 minutes of information, are you still keen on doing a PhD in the Netherlands? And while you think about that, we'll sort through some more questions that we will answer in writing. There are a number of personal questions that we received. I think it's useful that we will reply those people by email. Because we have roughly 25 open questions still. Some we have managed to get together and answer for you, but some of are that kind of personal nature that we'll send a short answer in writing. 73%, 80% of the people, 82% of the people have voted. We make this exciting. Now I give it 10 more minutes. We understand if you have to go. We see already people signing off. Thank you, Sarah, for joining us. And also, Eugenio, grazie. that's where my Spanish and my Italian ends. okay, well, here we go. We close the poll. Oh, yeah. Jeff Peters asks us about fact cards. Very good, Jeff. You win the bonus prize. We'll get to you, and you win an academic transfer pen. Yeah, the poll results, I'm going to share them with you. It's very nice to see that some of you are still considering it, but almost half of you are even more determined. We really think that is nice to see and hear that. Yeah, like I said, questions, feel free to email us or reach out through LinkedIn. Those that I still have available, I will answer shortly. After graduation, how do PhD students can get a permanent residence permit for the Netherlands? I think it's difficult for me to answer. It also depends on lots of other things. So your employer will then be able to help you, or the IND might be able to help you with that. Should I have undergrad master grades to be eligible for a PhD in the Netherlands? Yeah, this is an answer that is more of a general theme. If you have a degree, we have an organization in the Netherlands that will check the level of that degree. So in some cases, your undergraduate master might suffice, and some cases it might be considered not up to par, but then there might be something to mend that or separate that. So so as I said, you can check that with, it's from Duo. I don't know if they do it upfront or if you do it during the application procedures. We'll have to look into that, Tagrit, and we'll send you that email. We'll send it in the email. And for everybody else, NUFIC is also a great place to start, because they have this section, and they work together with grading. And of course, fact cards is something that you can always also go to. It's called factcards.nl. It's a website also maintained by Academic Transfer, funded by the Dutch universities, and you have all kinds of information from several teams, also from if you want to come to the Netherlands, how it goes with permits, but also if you want to stay in the Netherlands afterwards, what that means. It's more aimed and geared towards maybe postdocs and higher, but you can check maybe that information out. So if there anything here else that you think we should answer or that we maybe talk about, or is this time for us to say goodbye and wish everybody a great evening?
Yes, I think so.
Okay. Well, then, on behalf of Els and myself, I think it's let's throw on the camera one more time so you see how exhausted we are. Thank you for joining us on our first webinar Wednesday. We really enjoyed all your questions and your feedback and staying with us, because it was challenging, all those questions and doing the presentation. But please bear with us.
Thank you for your presence.
We hope to see or hear from you someday later on. So bye-bye.